The final section of this presentation will address issues of working with family caregivers. The following slides reveal some of the complex challenges that are encountered by traditional Japanese-American caregivers of individuals with dementia. Now let's go back a little bit and think about the values and attitudes that we talked about earlier. So just to reiterate, in very traditional Nikkei families, traditional beliefs mandate that mental health problems are a stigma and should not be discussed outside the family. They mandate that because of oyakoko, Nikkei family caregivers have a duty and an obligation to care for their parents no matter how difficult. Due to a belief in family privacy, problems with a family member should be solved within the family. And there should be a reluctance to seek help and to report embarrassing, shameful, or troublesome symptoms or behaviors to outsiders. But what you will see in the next slide depicts some different trends that we are seeing. The next generation trends. We have to remember that the Nikkei, the Japanese Americans, are the most acculturated and assimilated of all of the Asian Pacific Islander American subgroups. They are primarily English speaking now, the elders especially. Many younger generations, in fact, cannot speak or understand any Japanese. Outmarriage rates exceed 50%, which is resulting in a dilution of traditional Japanese American values and beliefs. We are finding shifts in what Nikkei parents expect from their adult children and changes in expectations for family care from these Nikkei parents. And as in mainstream populations, there are changes in women's roles and a growing acceptance of outside services. The current trend for sansei caregivers, based on data from the Kame Project, reveal the following. And remember that most sansei were born during World War II or after the camp experience, like myself. So what we are seeing from the sansei caregivers is there is more limited family elder care due to increasing employment and other demands. We see that their preferences are for blended rather than all Japanese services and providers. We see a greater openness to outside assistance, resulting in increasing demands for services and programs for dementia and Alzheimer's disease from other types of providers. And we also see changing attitudes towards institutionalization. That is, there's a greater acceptance found in areas where Japanese-specific skilled nursing facilities exist. And for your information, there actually are nursing homes that are ethnic-specific, particularly Japanese-American-specific, in Los Angeles. There's two, one in Boyle Heights of Los Angeles and one in Gardena. There's one in Seattle, Washington, and also one in Sacramento. Based on all this information, here are some suggestions for providers working with Nikkei family caregivers. First and foremost, acknowledge that the Japanese American population is very diverse, that one size fits all services are not appropriate, and that services cannot be based on different, on assumptions, particularly if you're dealing with the different generations of elders. It's important to be sensitive and knowledgeable about the past experiences of Nikkei families, particularly some wariness toward government systems and bureaucracies. It's important to train providers about the importance of establishing rapport and trust, so increasing awareness about language and food preferences where they exist, about protocols for family decision making. Is there an older son who makes the decisions, or maybe someone who is a healthcare provider? And there are other unique traits that make a difference in the perceived quality of services provided. And it's also very important to educate Nikkei caregivers about dementia and Alzheimer's disease and available support care and services and resources, and to encourage them to seek assessment and evaluation where they are available, if those services are available. I wanted to spend just a little bit of time telling you about a unique Japanese American community model. It's something that I have studied over the years a little bit, and it's something that I think other groups might have tried to model themselves in some respects, or maybe the Japanese American modeled it after other groups. But in the United States, mostly on the West Coast, there are communities of Japanese Americans where there are networks of JA services. For example, the San Francisco Bay Area, Seattle, Sacramento, Los Angeles, somewhat in the Central Valley of California, Chicago, and some other places. Well, what is there? There's an array of culturally appropriate Japanese-specific services, but the combinations vary by location. And that is to say, there are more services in the larger cities or where there are larger concentrations of Japanese Americans. These services range from senior centers to adult daycare programs to case management to nutrition programs and even to long-term care facilities. But again, they differ by geographic area, location, and population size. In all areas, I've found that caregiver support groups are gaining widespread support and interest. One example would be UIKai in San Jose, the Japanese Senior Center. They have a caregiver support group that deals not with just only with people with dementia, but other caregivers as well. And they have provided, over the course of their sessions, classes on caregiver skills building. So classes on how to cope with stress, how to reduce stress, problem solving, all of these different kinds of issues that caregivers come across. And it's very important to note that in this model, former care that is provided by the Japanese American service providers is considered an extension of family care. So to connect it back to the value of having the adult children take care of their own families, these services are seen by the younger generations as an extension of that family care. Other recommendations are very similar to what we recommend for other populations, but in terms of public policies, there needs to be increased availability of family resources, whether they be for financial or hands-on assistance or mental health services to help Nikkei caregivers and their families. We need to develop educational materials in varying formats that are written, videos, audio, etc., and that are at different levels and that are in the Japanese languages, if necessary. In terms of research, there's a need to develop culturally appropriate assessment tools for persons with dementia and Alzheimer's disease, as well as for caregivers, and particularly non-English speaking elders and their caregivers. And somewhere we need to reestablish and refund the Alzheimer's Disease Assessment Centers that study dementia in Japanese American populations. particularly if we know that there is a possibility of an impending hidden epidemic. So, in conclusion, I'd like to read to you this slide. Japanese Americans are the most assimilated of all Asian Pacific Islander populations. However, many elders and their caregivers maintain traditional Japanese language, customs, beliefs, and values. So cultural factors play a significant role in delivering appropriate care to Nikkei elders with dementia and contribute to a better quality of life for caregivers and their loved ones. Throughout this presentation, two symbols have appeared that represent the characteristics of the Nikkei as a group, I think. These symbols are one, the cranes, and cranes represent long life in Japan. People in Japan, as you probably know, are the longest lived in the world. So long life, health, and vitality is what I've hoped to depict here on these slides. The other symbol is bamboo. And bamboo, because like the Japanese American people, bamboo is strong, it's resilient, and it's capable of bending with the winds of adversity without breaking.